Good evening. I'm David Ferriero, the archivist of the United States, and it's a pleasure to welcome you this evening to the William G. McGowan Theater, and a special welcome to those of you who are joining us by YouTube. Tonight's program, Jazz in the USA, celebrates the 60th anniversary of the Newport Jazz Festival. Jazz is an American creation with improvisation as one of its distinguishing characteristics. It originated in the American South, and over the years, different styles of jazz have emerged, from New Orleans jazz, Kansas City jazz, and swing jazz, to many other kinds of jazz, some of which include elements of American pop music. Our discussion tonight is a signature event of Jazz at the National Archives, a five-month series of discussions, films, lectures, and performances we're presenting to celebrate jazz as a truly American art form, as well as to observe the Newport Jazz Festival's birthday. Tomorrow at noon, we'll continue screenings of Jazz, a film by Ken Burns, the 10-part series Ken directed that documents the history of jazz from its early beginnings in the late 1800s through the end of the 20th century. Next Thursday night, June 26th at 7 p.m., the world-renowned Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra Ensemble will be here to perform a concert of songs performed by composers and musician ambassadors who presented American jazz to international audiences. Those are just some of the terrific jazz-related programs you can see listed in the handout you received with tonight's program guide. The history of jazz is well documented in the holdings of the National Archives through our rich textual, photographic, motion picture, and sound holdings acquired from the State Department, the United States Information Agency, and other government entities. In fact, an entire series from our collection of films produced and distributed by the USIA, Jazz USA, is devoted to documenting the 1960 Newport Jazz Festival, and I believe we'll see a few clips from that tonight. In just a moment, our distinguished panel will celebrate with us the Newport Jazz Festival, its history, influence, and place in the contemporary jazz scene 60 years after its founding by the man we are honored to have with us tonight, Mr. George Wein. The panel will be moderated by Soledad O'Brien, an award-winning journalist and a member of the board of the Foundation for the National Archives. Joining Soledad and George will be Dan Morgenstern, one of the most noted and influential jazz critics and historians in the world, and two acclaimed jazz musicians, Christian McBride, who will be here on stage, and hopefully Jonathan Batiste, who, technology willing, will join us via the internet from Beirut, Lebanon, where he is performing. It's 2 o'clock a.m. in Beirut. So if you can hear me, Jonathan, good morning. But before we get to the panel, I would first like to acknowledge our partners and sponsors of tonight's program and all of the Jazz at National Archives programs, the National Archives Foundation, and our new friends at Natixis Global Asset Management. The Foundation supports all of the work of the Archives around education and outreach programs. The Foundation helps us bring more people to the Archives and make our audiences more aware of the rich trove of history in our holdings. Becoming a member of the Foundation is a good way to get involved with the National Archives, and there are applications for membership in the lobby, or you can become a member online at archivesfoundation.org. And a little inside scoop, no one has ever been turned down for membership in the Foundation. Also in the lobby are copies of our monthly calendar of events, which can keep you up to date with upcoming public programs. You'll also find a sign-up sheet to be included on our mailing list for the calendar, either by regular mail or email. Natixis is one of the world's leading asset managers and the principal sponsor of the Newport Jazz Festival. This year, in celebration of the 60th anniversary of the festival, Natixis is sponsoring jazz-related programs not only here at the National Archives, but in Boston and in Newport. These programs are part of its of 2014 Jazz Diplomacy Project, a series of events focused on connecting cultures, uniting communities, and enhancing the lives of individuals around the world. And to tell us more about this project, it's now my pleasure to turn the program over to John Hyler, President and CEO of Natixis.
Well, David, thanks for the introduction. One of the things, and I heard it tonight, one of the great things about music and jazz and talking about musicians playing and they pick up wherever they are in the world and start to play together and all of a sudden there's a bond. And I had an opportunity to sit with a couple of people that are passionate and love of music and jazz in particular. And one of those people, Dr. Wes Watkins, had a line tonight. I may not be a musician, but I'm musical. And I have this belief in music that it's an important communicator for all of us around the world. I have an opportunity through my company to travel throughout the world, and one of the things you will hear constantly is the sound of jazz. And one of the things that jazz is, it's an American invention that has been taken by the world and been into many changes and cultural add-ons. And wherever you go in the world, you hear some unique brand of it, whether you're in Latin America, Africa, the Middle East, Asia, Europe. It's just really quite amazing how this genre has changed and moved. And one of the things that occurred was an epiphany a few years ago. And I had been to Newport as a young person, but never later on in life because I had moved on to other things. And then one day I read a little blip in, I think it was the New York Times, that said George Wein had taken back and turned the Newport Jazz Festival into a foundation. And I said, wow, that's great. That's the grandmother, grandfather. It's the start of all the jazz festivals around the world. It's kept the music alive and global. And I said, boy, as a company, that's something we should get behind. That's something we should help. And that's how George and I became friends and we got involved in Newport. And through that meeting and his passion and belief in the music, he got me introduced to people like Dr. Jackie Modeste and musicians and artists, producers, people that just care about the music. And what I'm impressed about was the National Archives. And when we came down here, they began to talk about Newport and the films that they had and the things that you've done. And we talked to George, and George was like, wow, this is a great idea. And we talked to the National Archives, and this is a great idea. So people can communicate, and the thing that made us communicate was this idea of jazz and music. So it's an honor and a privilege to be able to continue this dialogue and to continue to share this wealth. And what I'm hoping happens is when you see this, not just about the history of Newport, it's about the future of jazz and how viable and great a music this truly is. And it's our opportunity here to share that and share what we're going to see tonight with other people after we leave here. So again, it's an honor to be here. It's an honor to get to know the people that keep these things alive, keep them growing, and keep them vibrant. And again, thank you for attending tonight, and I hope you appreciate the show. David, thank you to the National Archives for a great job. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Soledad O'Brien is an award-winning journalist, documentarian, news anchor, and producer, and has reported on breaking news from around the globe. She's the originator of the highly successful documentary series Latino in America and Black in America. In June 2013, O'Brien launched Starfish Media Group, a multi-platform media production and distribution company. She's also joined the Harvard University as a distinguished fellow and appointed to the National Archives Foundation Board.
And what I'm hoping happens is when you see this, not just about the history of Newport, it's about the future of jazz and how viable and great and music this truly is. And it's our opportunity here to share that.
Please welcome Soledad O'Brien and our panel to the stage.
So sometimes I forget things that I say.
Thank you, John. Soledad O'Brien is a award-winning journalist, documentarian, news anchor, and producer.
Good evening,
everyone. Reported on breaking news from around the globe. She's the originator of the highly successful documentary series Latino in America and Black in America. In June 2013, O'Brien launched the Starfish Media Group,
Okay. Is that what the noise is? Hey, Jonathan, can you hear me? This is Soledad. Would you do me a favor and do you need that to hear us?
Not just about the history of Newport, about the future of jazz and how viable.
Oh, you know what that is? That's he's streaming the show here, and he's getting it on delay. That's what's happening. Okay. So here's what we're gonna do. I'm going to tell you how tonight is gonna work. I'm very honored to be here and be part of our celebration of 60 years of the Newport. I'm going to introduce all of our panelists, including Jonathan, who's solving these technological problems. And then we'll have a chance to have a conversation for a little bit, look at some still photos, look at a little bit of a film from really the past 60 years, and then we'll open it up to your questions as well. So we're really thrilled to be here. So we'll start with the gentleman to my direct right. George Wein is a pianist and NEA Jazz Master, producer of the Newport Jazz Festival, and the former owner of the Jazz Club Storyville at the Copley Square Hotel in Boston. He is, of course, as legendary as his festivals, having launched the first and most significant jazz festival in 1954 in Newport.
Yeah.
Literally hundreds since that day. At age 87?
Okay, how's that?
You wish? Whatever number you want to agree to is what I'll go with.
88 going on 89.
George's contributions to jazz are literally too numerous to list and still make it through our program this evening, but suffice it to say, his value is enormous, and many would say his value is incalculable. His full bio is in your program, and in fact, the full bios for all of our panelists are in your program. I'm going to encourage you to take a look as I just do short introductions. We're also joined this evening by Dan Morgenstern. He is a historian, a writer, an educator, a multiple Grammy Award winner. He, too, is a jazz master, the nation's highest jazz honor. He's been the editor of Downbeat Magazine, the last editor of Metronome, the first editor of Jazz Magazine. He has been a jazz reviewer for the New York Post and the Chicago Sun-Times. It's a pleasure to have you, sir. Thank you for being with us. To his right is Christian McBride. He is a bassist and a composer and an arranger and an educator and a curator and an administrator. He, too, studied at Juilliard in classical studies. And in 1989, he moved to New York City to become a sideman in the jazz world, performing with the most renowned musicians in jazz, in R&B, in rock, in hip-hop, and even in opera. He also leads his own ensembles. It's nice to have you with us, Christian, as well. And we see Jonathan Batiste. I hope he can hear us as well. He is in Beirut tonight for us, tomorrow morning for him. He is a pianist and a band leader and an entertainer and an educator. He comes from a family of musicians in New Orleans and recorded his very first album in New Orleans at the age of 17. He, too, studied at Juilliard. He is also the associate director at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. It's nice to have you with us, Jonathan. Thank you for joining us in Beirut. And Jonathan, since I don't know, our connection seems a little tenuous, we're going to start with you. So we'll put it right to the test from the get-go. And then we'll discover if you can hear me or not. I'm going to show a picture in just a moment of you performing at Jazz Fest. But tell me from a musician's perspective, what does it mean to be on that stage? What does it mean to perform at the Newport Jazz Festival?
Well, to perform at Newport Jazz is to be a part of a continuum. You have the great musicians of the jazz legacy, all the way back to Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, I mean, the titans of jazz, who performed on that stage. And what they stand for is still represented with the festival till this day. So that's rare in itself. I mean, an actual jazz festival that's not only just a jazz festival in name. And to be a part of that is really amazing, especially as a younger artist coming up to really coming into your own and really trying to find your voice as the great masters had before us.
Jonathan, can you hear me? Can you hear me? That's a B+ I give you for that.
It's gonna be a tough night.
Wait, man.
You know what? Maybe we should go to Christian, who can help you out a little bit. I mean, he only got a B+ for that answer. Do you wanna give him some assistance?
I don't know how much more I can add on to that, but he's absolutely right. It's one of the greatest traditions in the history of jazz. And as a teenager growing up in Philadelphia, I that's probably the first jazz festival I ever heard about, even ones outside of my hometown. I knew about Newport. And the first time I got a chance to perform there in 1991, all of us knew that we were on hollow ground. We were just looking around like, wow, it's Newport, dude. Check it out. You know, so and I've been very honored to play there many, many times since. And it's one of the few jazz festivals anywhere in the world that's actually true to its billing. It really is a jazz festival. Most jazz festivals are 70% pop and rock, but just enough jazz to justify it calling it a jazz festival. But Newport has always given the presented the top-notch musicians in this craft of jazz.
George, take us back to the beginning, 1954. What were you thinking it would be and it could be as you were heading to create this for the first time?
You know, I really don't know. The Lorillards came to see me, and they're from Newport. They wanted to liven up the summer. And I said to myself, well, I didn't know what to do concerts or set up a club. But then I said, there's a classical music festival in Tanglewood in New England. And I said, why can't we have a jazz festival? And what we did different was, see, I knew every jazz fan in New England because they'd been coming to the club. And I knew what attractions drew people. And I put them all together at one time, you know, Dizzy Gillespie, Billie Holiday, Ella Fitzgerald, you know. And we took over this famous tennis casino, set up 5,000 seats on the lawn, and we sold it out. And you probably read the great article in the New Yorker that in Vogue magazine, but everybody, we were hip. We were the scene, you know, we were happening. Now jazz is just surviving as the great music it is. And it's because of people like Jonathan and Christian and so many young people that this festival is just going to keep going and jazz is going to keep going. So, but what was I thinking? We call it the first annual. And we didn't know whether we were going to have a second one. So.
Here's a review from the New York Times, 1954. The people who thought up and carried out the jazz festival in Newport, Rhode Island last weekend meant well. And considering that this was an initial effort, did a good job. Naturally, there were errors in judgment and execution in the handling of the enterprise, and valuable lessons have been learned. One of the gravest mistakes lay in the approach to jazz, and if it is not eradicated, the undertaking will cease to be a festival and become more like a weighty seminar.
Who wrote that?
Dan. Oh, you know what? This was written by Howard Taubman in the New York Times.
Yeah. Howard Taubman, you know, critics were wonderful. We went to... he's been the best critic we had, by the way. There's no joke about that. We went to Brussels one time, and I put on a big program at the Brussels World's Fair. And we brought Sarah Vaughan, and we brought Teddy Wilson and Sidney Bechet. And Howard Taubman wrote an article about how could we ask those people to represent jazz in America? So I wrote him a letter. I never write letters to critics. I never wrote you a letter, did I? And what happened, Howard Taubman said after that, I will never write about jazz again. and was very good about that.
Dan, he went on to write this. It is a fair question whether a jazz festival should be held out of doors at all. The music becomes diffused, and when 7,000 people are scattered through a large enclosure, a unit of three or four or five players has the devil of a time making contact with the listeners. As a critic yourself, what was the takeaway, the fallout? What did people think at the end of 1954?
Well, you know, today we consider this genre, jazz festival, is taken for granted. It's universal. And we tend to forget what a novelty Newport was. And what you read there from Howard Taubman, who was not a jazz guy, actually, but the New York Times didn't have a jazz critic in 1954. They eventually got one, John Wilson, who was there for years. John had some silly things to say about Newport, too. But we tend to forget what you quoted something that jazz outdoors becomes too diffuse. It's nonsense. You know, Tanglewood, which George mentioned, is outdoors. That didn't enter into the picture at all. The fact that it was outdoors was such a novelty. And I remember I missed the first couple of Newports, but then I didn't miss any, you know, after that. One of the great things to observe backstage, well, there was no real backstage at Freebody Park, but where the musicians would gather, was that guys would and girls would see each other who hadn't seen each other in years, and there were all these reunions. We tend to forget that musicians in those days were playing in clubs, and they were traveling on their own. They didn't get together. You know, you leave one city and you go to another. It was very rarely that. This became an in-gathering of musicians. It was wonderful to observe that. See, people hadn't seen each other in years and were so happy to see each other. And also the audience, I mean, the very first ones, I guess it was pretty much limited to New England people. And you gotta forget that Rhode Island, Newport, was a society. You know, it was a navy town too. You know, but it was a hangout for millionaires. So that was the prestigious part of it. And we mentioned Taubman, but the really important coverage for Newport was in the New Yorker, and that was a lady named Lillian Ross who did a wonderful piece about that. And she really hit on all the different important angles of this. And then, you know, it from Newport, George branched out with other festivals, and then it just grew and grew like Topsy and eventually became a universal phenomenon. But we tend to forget how innovative that was and how taking jazz out of smoky nightclubs and putting it out into the open, into beautiful natural surroundings, it was a really important thing. It's very consequential.
George, how hard was it to stack the show? I mean, figuring out who would go first and who would be included, and I mean, was it fraught with fights and arguments? Who would be the big jazz stars? You had all of the bold-faced names over the years. Who would be the young up-and-comers that you would tap, and who would be those who jazz purists would not appreciate, but you felt had to be in? And how did you make those decisions?
Well, probably who was getting the least money to open the show and who was getting the most money close the show. So I think that really sums it up in one sentence. Because other than that, I wouldn't know how to do it. I mean, what we do now at Newport is much better, because we had one stage at the beginning. We have three stages now. And so we have like literally 15 groups a night. And there a real camaraderie sets in, because they do know what you were talking about. They can all, between sets, they go listen to each other and they hang out, and it's really great. But I don't know how we did that. You know, I always had a sense of showbiz that, you know, that we used to have afternoon programs, and with the groups that we didn't feel were ready for prime time, like Thelonious Monk and Charles Mingus, and we'd put them on in the afternoon, and then slowly but surely they became the stars at night. So this is what we're hoping now, that the groups we have, that particularly on the Friday at Newport, where we're charging $40 for an incredible program with John Batiste as the star, you know, hey, John. And, he always knows how to steal a show, this guy. I mean, he really does. He's a magnificent entertainer, and he's wonderful. But we hope that those people, and we know what Christian's going to do, because Christian's a born leader. I mean this. He is a leader. He is one of the people that is going to carry jazz into the next generations. And let me tell you, Christian, he has a trio right now that will bring you back to the feelings of what you used to have with Oscar Peterson. So, I mean, it's a tremendous thing that you have people like John Batiste and Christian McBride. I don't know who picked these musicians for this panel, but they did the right job.
What did it mean and does it mean for your career when early on you were really chosen and highlighted and it caused some tension, actually, right, when you were...
Well, I think you're speaking of another festival.
Mm-hmm, the one in Philly, right?
Yeah. It used to be a festival called the Mellon Jazz Festival, which happened in Philly and in Pittsburgh. And one of the traditions of that festival was that they would dedicate, or they would have a featured artist... they would dedicate the festival to a local Philadelphia or Pittsburgh musician. So in 1994, this man here, George Wein, picked me to be the featured artist that year. The festival would be dedicated to me. And at the time, I was 22. So there were a lot, you talk about nasty letters and phone calls. I had just signed my first solo deal on Verve Records, and you know, I virtually had only really been touring for about 5 years. And it had gotten so intense, I called George's office. I said, man, I can't take this. They got these older guys calling my mother, talking about, you know, he doesn't deserve this, you know. So, and I'll never forget, George said, listen, I picked you because I think you're going to have some long legs in this business. And, you know, you're not a fly-by-night guy. You're going to be here for a long time. So I'm sticking with you. but that still didn't help the phone calls from the older musicians in Philly. So we wound up striking a balance, and it was dedicated that year to me and posthumously Lee Morgan. And of course, all the guys who love Lee Morgan was like, well, he should get his own day. So, can't win.
Jonathan, you talked a little bit about being part of the history of the Newport Festival. But were there real tangible things that came out of it for you as a performer, as an entertainer? What did you walk away with that changed how you played?
Well, every performance has a different atmosphere because the audience creates this exchange with the band, and the band feels different every time we step on stage. And jazz is based in improvisation, so with all of these different variables, there's a really different, I guess it's a different emotion and a different experience, as I like to call it, that happens at each performance. And I think the Newport experience left us with something that you don't find in too many places anywhere in the world that we've played. It's a classic jazz experience because the audience knows how to listen to the music and they know how to respond at the appropriate times. They know when to be quiet and to kind of cool out. And they also have this appreciation for the history of it. So when you reference something that's a part of that history, they actually hear it and see what you did to update it or contemporize it, if you will. So it kind of left us with hope that there's actually still an audience, and there's a place where we can grow that audience with young people.
I'm going to take a moment to show folks some of the stills that, Jason, we can click through. The first one we have, I think, is of Jonathan. There he is. That's from the 2013 Newport Festival. The next one is Dizzy playing at Newport. If we click through this photo, Jason, right there. And after that, a really great shot of Miles Davis a little bit later on in his career. Let's show that picture. We could roll through pictures for folks of every boldface name in jazz over the 60 years that the festival has existed. Dan, do you have a favorite? Is there someone who you say, or a performance that you say is the one that stands out to you as the performance?
Well, that would be very hard to do because there were so many wonderful moments. I remember one time when Louis Armstrong was on, he was on last, I think, because he couldn't follow Louis. And it had been one of those nights when the festival, which was supposed to end, I think legally it was supposed to end at 1 o'clock, something like that. But it went on a little longer. Newport at night, sometimes when the weather was nice, because it's by the water, and it's damp, music outdoors just had a wonderful sonic quality. And Louis was in good form that night. And eventually, he kept asking for encores, and eventually he did what he always did when he wanted to put a stop. He would play the national anthem. Wow. Which is not, I don't think, well, I don't want to get into that, but it's not really a great tune, is it? But he played it so beautifully. And that particular festival, James Baldwin's sister, Gloria, was covering it for Ebony magazine, and she brought her brother along. And I had known Jimmy for quite some time. And I was probably the only person, really, that he knew there. So we were hanging out together. And after Louis stopped playing the national anthem, he turned to me and he said, "You know, that's the first time I've liked that song." Sometimes there were many attractions on a given night. Sometimes too many. in this particular occasion, there were only two. And they were Errol Garner, who always performed with a trio, and Duke Ellington. And Errol opened, and I was back. And Errol, how many of you have seen Errol Garner live? There must be quite a few of you there. Anyway, he's really the only musician I've ever encountered who was able to entrance an audience just by playing the piano. Didn't ever say anything, he didn't say a word, but just what he did communicated so well that it was no wonder that he eventually became one of the highest paid concert attractions in the world of jazz. But anyway, he opened and he was in rare form, and Duke was back there and he said, "How are we going to follow that?" The Ellington Orchestra. They managed. It was a wonderful night. That was just one of those nights that I will never forget.
There's a story about that night, because for some reason or other, I looked around and Duke had two bass players playing with him. I said, "Duke, why do you have two bass players?" He said, "With that Errol Garner left hand, I need two bass players."
That's right.
I'd like to play a clip of Dave Brubeck and performing. So let's roll that, Jason, will you? The film? I'm not sure what year it's from.
Oh.
you bump that volume for me so we can hear it a little? Year would you guess that was? And how many times did Dave Brubeck perform at the Newport Jazz Festival?
Well, in 60 years, my guess is Dave played 30 to 35 times. Every other year we'd bring him and sometimes follow it up. And one of the reasons that musicians are popular with the public, but it's not that. It's you like musicians on a festival that will cooperate with what you're doing. That is sometimes a major problem. Because sometimes you do ask somebody to open, you do ask somebody to close, you say, I remember nights when I'd ask Dave to play a 35-minute set because we had a time problem. Dave would just do whatever was necessary. Some nights I'd say, play 80 minutes because we want to give more. But I do want to get in something right now, because we're here in the National Archives building. And this has got to do with the history of America. And believe me, jazz is part of the history of America. It has to do with what this country, the Declaration of Independence, which we see all around this building, and liberty and justice for all. Well, we didn't have liberty and justice for all at the start of this nation. It just didn't exist. But we had a group of people that provided a music and a rhythm and a sensitivity and a sense of life that was lacking in most everyone else here. And from the period, like we talk mythologically about Congo Square. It was much broader than that, but let's say Congo Square, where the slaves would create music and drums and dancing. And then classical musicians would take from that, and you had a man by the name of Gottschalk that took and wrote a classical composition from the banjo playing. But jazz, bringing this minority group, which didn't want to be here in the first place, but became part of our life and part of our culture, bringing them into the mainstream of our life. Jazz was one of the most important things that did that, from the days of Jelly Roll Morton to Louis Armstrong to Duke Ellington to everyone you can mention, and then bringing into the contemporary scene. And that is part of our history and should be part of the archives of this nation. And that's why I'm so grateful for you.
Were there ever any tricky issues around race to navigate in the 60 years of the Newport Festival?
We had a problem the very first year, because it was a Navy town, Newport. A lot of sailors from the South, you know, and it was way before the Civil Rights Act, 1954. But the difference was in doing what we did. I mean, it was this bad. One of the famous people in Newport said, I want to have a party for the musicians. I want to big houses out on the Ocean Drive. But please don't invite too many of the Africans. So I obliged. I invited nobody to the party. You see? So, but 5 years later, they elected an African American to the mayorship of New Orleans. So we had our impact, and it meant a lot.
Let's talk, and Dan, maybe I'll throw this to you first, about the riots in the sort of the two versions that you and I have talked about in the past. Walk me through what happened, even to this day. There are sort of debates about what really caused the riot that would end up with you know, fire hoses and 1,000 young people sort of coming onto the stage, or at least trying to get onto the stage, and a real out-and-out melee.
Problems are caused when the people doing the festival and the city powers that be do not work together. And what happened was a lot of people resented the festival. We did not think it was necessary to work with City Hall. We did not know. Nobody had ever done festivals. And the next thing we knew, we had thousands of people, but the key to that festival problem, nobody ever wrote, business, business, business. There was a 1 o'clock closing of all the bars. And after about the fourth or fifth year with all the people in town, the businessmen in town said, why don't we keep those clubs open till 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning? And thousands of people descended on Newport that never came there because it was an oasis in a sea of 1 o'clock closings. And it began really. And so the next thing you know, we had these mobs of people. And to give you an example, the headline said, riot at Newport Jazz Festival the next day. Nobody wrote that the police came to me that night and said, George, keep the concert going till 2 o'clock so we can clean up what's happening outside. So, I mean, that's history.
What was the takeaway? What was the impact long term of that, Dan?
Well, the first one wasn't really a riot. It was that a lot of people showed up and couldn't get in, and among them were a bunch of college kids who got drunk and started throwing beer cans and stuff. And local cops didn't really know how to deal with that. But the second one was a more serious event. And
that was
in 70 or 69? Was
71.
I think we have a still that we can show, actually, while you continue to talk about it, Dan.
Kids scaled the fences and descended on the stage. Oh, you can't really get a sense of
I think that's the 20,000 people who were asked to file out of there in 1970.
The difference between the two so-called riots, too, is that the first one was when the festival was still held in Freebody Park, which was a sports arena in Newport. And could only, what was the capacity of that? It was limited, the amount of people you could shoehorn in there. The second one was after George, I think you bought some land there and you built a wonderful stage, or you leased the land, but you built this great stage. It's a beautiful stage. And there was room for a lot more people. But then there were these kids, you know, this was at a time in American history when there were a lot of young people who felt that they were entitled. They were entitled to get everything for free. And there had been, you know, rock and roll events that were free. And so a bunch of them scaled the fences and descended upon the audience and on the stage. And some of them tried to set fire to it and tried to destroy the grand piano that was on stage. And meanwhile, things that I remember, Stefan Grappelli, you know, that was a wonderful French violinist. I think it was Stefan's first Newport. Poor Stefan was absolutely scared to death. It was, I thought, you know, I mean, he was white, but he turned white as a sheet. but there was another reaction, which I'll never forget. And I think they say, you know, don't speak ill of the dead, but I do want to say this. I was up, you know, near the front of the stage, which was the press section, and that's what performers were, too, when they were not performing. Nina Simone got up on a chair and started cheering these idiots on who were on the stage trying to destroy it. So, you know, that spelled the end of Newport for some for some time, but George came back. George is a comeback guy.
George, in your book, you write about getting Frank Sinatra to perform at Newport, and I'm going to read a little bit of it. After returning from Europe, I received a call from Willard. He told me that Frank was interested. I asked, Frank who? I had forgotten about our previous conversation, and that was it. Sinatra agreed to appear at the Newport Jazz Festival with the Basie Band. Sinatra was at his peak of popularity. As soon as we finalized the contract and issued a press release, the newspapers picked up the story. One paper reported, the news, Sinatra is coming, started a gold rush matched only by teenagers in search of seats to a Beatles bash. Even though our other programs featured major attractions, nothing could compare to the demand for Sinatra tickets. There were 12,000 reserved seats in Festival Field, and they were going as fast as we could sell them.
I was very grateful to Frank for coming there. And like Willard Alexander always said, I'm going to see Frank on the West Coast. I said, Frank? And I said, well, ask Frank if he'd like to come to Newport. And Willard did, and Frank came to Newport. But I was very grateful because at that time, Newport was at a low ebb because that was right after the Beatles and rock and roll music had taken over all the youth in the country. And we were really at a low level after being there for the years we were. But when Frank Sinatra came, it focused attention on Newport again. That lasted for a good few years. But all these things are cyclical, you know. So festivals are cyclical. You always have to remember that we have your good years, you go up, and then changes change, the vogues change. But jazz doesn't change, and that's why I stay with jazz. You know what I mean?
Jason, we have a couple of shots of Frank Sinatra performing the next two slides. Let's show those, and then go ahead. You were going to say?
George, I wanted to ask you about a story. The great Roy Haynes witnessed that set when Sinatra sang with the Basie Band. And he said it was one of the greatest show-stopping performances he ever saw. What he remembers most is that at the end, Sinatra is singing Fly Me to the Moon for his final number. Just as they get to the final 16 bars, Frank gives the nod to his guy. I guess Frank traveled to Newport via helicopter. So his helicopter was parked behind the stage. And right when they get to the last 16 bars, Frank looks at his guy, the propeller start up on the helicopter. And he said, just like while the band is playing the vamp out, Frank flies off in his helicopter. And he said, man, that was the baddest thing I'd ever seen in my whole life.
Jason, why don't you move forward to the next shot? There we go. Forward to another shot, please, if you don't mind. I think we have a couple of shots of Sinatra. And the next one after this as well, which was described as the miracle on the hillside. What made it such a miracle?
Well, there was a field there 4 weeks before, and the next thing you know, the 12,000 chairs set up a reservation, and with a stage and everything, they couldn't believe it. How could it be done to present Sinatra on an open field, and all of a sudden have 12,000 reserved seats? And so that was the miracle on the hillside. The miracle was that Frank came there with Quincy Jones and Count Basie and Oscar Peterson. And Christian's right, but what I remember that night, because Father O'Connor was there. I don't know if you remember the jazz priest, Father O'Connor. He was my closest friend. And Frank came off the stage and said, thank you, Father O'Connor. Thank you, George. And went right to his helicopter, which we had cleared a space for him. There were two helicopters. And Stan Getz was there, and he made a remark. The helicopter said, there goes Frank. There goes the money.
Well, I'm going to ask one more question, then I'm going to open it up to everyone else if you have a question. Go ahead,
one little story, because it reminded me, just around that same time, Pepsi Cola, I think, had a sponsorship in Newport. And at that time, one of the members of the Pepsi-Cola board was Joan Crawford. And Joan Crawford came to Newport. And on a sunny, hot afternoon, she took to the stage. I think George introduced her and started making a speech. Now, this is sort of like intermission between two sets. And nobody was paying any attention. It's outdoors. It's in the afternoon. There are a lot of young people. So she started to speak, and nobody was paying any attention. And gradually, she became more and more infuriated. And she started cussing out the audience. And who came to the rescue but Duke Ellington, who had a way with the ladies? Duke Ellington came up on the podium next to her, put his arm around her, and waltzed her off the stage into the back. It was perfect, absolutely perfect.
Before we open up to questions, and you'll notice there is a microphone there and a microphone there, so if you have a question, I'm going to ask you now to stand up and make your way to one of those microphones so we can get to you. Tell me about Louis Armstrong's birthday celebration at the Newport Jazz Festival.
Louis Armstrong, of course, was, Louis invented the jazz language. Before Louis, nobody played behind the beat. Nobody knew what swing really was. It came out of the ragtime music. But Louis Armstrong is probably the single most important figure in the history of jazz. And because everybody that followed had played behind the beat and could swing. And but his 70th birthday, Pops had been ill. And he came to Newport. And historically, we can talk too much, so I can't. But because Dan talked about an evening when Louis played the Star Spangled Banner, that was a night where Louis wouldn't cooperate with anything we wanted. And the way he voiced his displeasure with what was happening by shutting down the show by playing Star Spangled Banner. And so that's exactly what happened that night. But now Louis was 70 years old, he was ill. And he was cooperating completely. And it was one of the great joys. We did a film on that night. And I wanted him to sing with Mahalia Jackson. They'd never worked together, but they're both from New Orleans. They'd left many years before, but they were both from New Orleans. So Mahalia gets on, does her set, which is marvelous. You know Mahalia Jackson? Any of you know Mahalia Jackson? She's absolutely, if the angels could sing, they'd sound like Mahalia Jackson. And she started singing Just a Closer Walk with Thee, and we put Louis out to sing with her. What was that? Just a Closer Walk?
I don't know.
Yes?
Sounds like...
Okay. And of course, Louis didn't know the lyrics, but in the movie, you can hear her telling Louis, and she's singing, Just a Closer Walk, Just a Closer Walk. and it was just marvelous. It was one of the great moments I've ever seen. So it was a truly historic night, and it was one of the great programs I've ever had the privilege of ever producing, that 70th birthday of Louis.
He said this about you. He knows who to get and where to place them. Is that ultimately sort of the magic of the success of the Newport Jazz Festival? Kind of who you get and where they go in the lineup.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Pops.
Let's open it up to some questions. We'll start over here, sir. A couple of rules before we get to questions. Anybody who's ever been interviewed by me before knows that I like questions that have actual questions in them. I will stop you if they don't. So go ahead.
Well, thank you for being here tonight. Thank you for bringing your history from the elderly to the young. I'd like to know, are you all familiar with Ethel Ennis? And also, what would you say to young people who are pursuing any form of music?
Is that for me?
Ethel Ennis.
Well, let's ask it for anyone on the panel. Ethel Ellis. Ethel Ennis was the question.
She's a fine singer. I think she's from, is she from Baltimore originally? She's from Baltimore. I haven't heard of her in quite some time, but she's an excellent singer, yes.
She sang at Newport many years ago, and in her career, I don't know why her career didn't take off, but she's a great singer.
And then your second part of your question was, what advice do you give young people?
Yes.
You know, sometimes when you talk to jazz musicians, and a couple that I've talked to over the last months, sometimes they're very down on the future of jazz. They look around and say, well, everybody's listening to 2 Chainz, and the young people are not listening to jazz, and it's a hard sell at times. So what would your advice or counsel be to someone like that?
Ask Jonathan that.
Well, I think that when you talk about the history of jazz and you talk about this community and how it was really creating a sound that reflected the deepest, most profound sentiments of what people were dealing with at that time, and then you look at millennials and the generation of the internet and all of this stuff that we have, I think there are more ways now than ever before for us actually to connect. And I think that's the beauty of jazz. You can use a lot of the things that we have at our disposal to bring young people into the music. But I think the main thing is really just exposure to it and taking it out of the context of maybe just the jazz club or somewhere where they have a preconceived notion of it being not cool or whatever. You know, so, I mean, sometimes we even take it to the streets. In New York, we play in the subway even. And we don't ask for money. We just play. And we've built up a pretty strong fan base of younger people. When I say young, I say, you know, 30 and under, of people who had heard us just playing in odd locations like the subway or playing on a street corner or something like that. So I really do think that, you know, there's a lot of ways for us to connect right now. And if you can figure out a way to inventively put jazz into all of these different things we have at our disposal in an engaging way that will engage the mind of a young person, I think there's a lot of hope. I'm actually pretty optimistic about it.
Our next question is over here. Go ahead, sir.
Yes, I'd like to ask, so any of y'all know Noble Jolly? Because he was just up the street at the Portrait Gallery, him and his band. The band is young. And before I came down here, I was listening to them, and they were pretty good. And the thing about getting jazz, they need to get in the elementary school and the middle schools. Teach the kids in elementary schools and middle schools. It's supposed to be America's music, American history. It should be taught in the schools.
But since it's not taught in the schools anymore, we have to be proactive about taking our young people. Like Jonathan said, it's about exposure. One thing that I feel is almost guaranteed is that if you take a young person that, you know, it's kind of cool at some point in your lifetime to sit around and say, boy, these young folks don't know nothing about no good music, you know. But if you really feel that way, you need to take a 8, 10, 13, 15, 18-year-old and say, hey, let me turn you on to some music that you need to know about. And what happened with me, with my mother, with all of my uncles, they would play these jazz records for me. And at age 9, I didn't get it. At 10, I didn't get it. At 11, I started to get it. 12, 13, all of a sudden it started to grow. And the more that I was exposed to this music, the more I loved it. So I think there's a myth, again, kind of jumping on what Jonathan said, there's this myth with jazz that it's too cerebral, it's too esoteric, you can't jam to it, you know. But if you really take some young minds, some young people, and get them out there and see all of the different varieties of this great music that's out there, it's going to hit them one way or the other.
One of the things we've dedicated at Newport, and we can do it, we're nonprofit now, and we have people like John Hyler of Natixis coming in and supporting us, and we're bringing in the high school bands to play. But our own project for the future is to literally bring jazz into the schools. I know when I was a kid in the Depression days back in the 30s, they used to bring musicians into grammar school. And I didn't necessarily, it wasn't jazz, but I heard a whole orchestra playing Rhapsody in Blue when I was about 7 years old. It affected my whole life. So bringing things into the schools is very, very important.
And there's a lot of after-school programs that are happening in the country right now. My wife and I actually run an after-school program in Montclair, New Jersey called Jazz House Kids, where if you play an instrument, you can come take private lessons. You can play in small ensembles. You can play in big bands. As a matter of fact, our big band came in second in the Essentially Ellington competition this year. Thank you. So in Oakland, Los Angeles, New Orleans, Philadelphia, there's all kinds of after-school programs that you can start doing some research on. If you know some young people that want to play an instrument, go send them to that.
Question over here.
Exposure, exposure is the key word. And I was actually going to mention that Jazz Kids, man, because last summer you were on it, and Nat Cohn and some other people, and then the band came on, the big band, and I was amazed at what they could do. Just young kids, and they were playing bassy stuff and something, but they were really good. So exposure and good teachers, and but there's so many talented young musicians out there today. Anybody who says that the future of jazz is in doubt, I think they're absolutely wrong.
Yeah.
It's gonna last. It'll never go away.
Sir?
My question is for George. Compared to some of the cleaner living jazz musicians of today, I was just wondering if you had any colorful anecdotes from the 1950s or 60s with some of the folks like Billie Holiday, who had a substance of erratic behavior and substance abuse. And were there ever any moments there where things happened where you might have thought that the whole thing was going to come unraveled because of the colorful anecdotes or the antics, of some of the musicians?
But, I mean, I can't answer that. I mean, Billie Holiday, we took her out to dinner one day in Durgan Park in Boston. I don't even know Durgan Park. It's a great old restaurant. And we ordered a lobster for her. And she was very upset because the lobster she checked. "I want a female lobster," she said. she wasn't wrong about that. See, female lobsters have a roe in it that the male lobsters don't have. It adds to the taste. But when, at that point, Billie Holiday's asking for a female lobster. I mean, but hey, we can go through stories for the next hour. I mean, I can't answer that. But knowing all those people, knowing Miles and Monk, I was on the, I was the international impresario, and Monk and Mingus and Dizzy and everybody is Sassy, and they were my life, I just can't. I read my book. That's what I'm saying.
I would second that. It's a great book. It's one of the best jazz books of the hundreds that I've read. It's really highly recommended.
We've got a question here, and anyone else who has a question, please don't forget to line up at this microphone there. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, what year did the festival move to Fort Adams State Park, and what facilitated that move, and how did you eventually find that to be the most accommodating venue?
What was that?
What year did the festival move to Fort Adams State Park, and how did you find that, and why did that become the most accommodating venue?
I'm glad you asked that, because that was the first sign of total cooperation with the state of Rhode Island, the city of Newport, with the festival. when they gave us Fort Adams, when we had gone to New York after the problem in 1971 that Danny brought up, and when music should be free, and they broke the fences down. But when I decided to go back there, I think it was 1980, and they showed that they really appreciated what the Newport Jazz Festival meant. And they have cooperated with us, and of course we have cooperated with them to every extent. That solves the problem of what we had in 1960, when the people putting on the festival, myself and whoever the board, were not working with the city. Now we work together hand in glove, and it's just beautiful relationship. Thank you about that question. Thank you very much.
Go ahead, sir.
I was just wondering how much of the festival music was recorded, how many albums have come out of that, and is there any effort being made to release more of it on recordings?
The record companies don't record like they used to because the record business isn't what it used to be. But fortunately, we have a lot of tapes. And for instance, Amir El-Safar recorded with his tape. We would never release those tapes unless the musicians are paid for and want to do them themselves. Dave Douglas took one of the tapes and released an album. Amir El-Safar did it. And see, the tapes are there because of Anya. Anya's out here. Where is she? NPR. Broadcast the festival, and thank you very much, Anya, for doing that. But that gives us a source. That gives us a source, and so if your group wants to use those tapes, because that's something that I have never and never will do in my life, is ever issue a tape that doesn't belong to me because it belongs to the musicians. And so there have been a few things done, you know, on that, you know.
Question over here. Go ahead, sir.
First of all, Mr. Morgenstern, I want to tell you that I miss liner notes, and especially reading yours, which were great. I think one of the iconic images from Jazz on a Summer Day is of Anita O'Day singing. And every time I see that, I wonder, why aren't I listening to more Anita O'Day, because it's amazing. Did any of you have any comments on that performance or on that particular movie in general?
It was the hat she wore. She's a great artist. I mean, there's only one Anita O'Day. And she just knew what to do that day. And she wore this hat, and it was great to film. You know, I didn't do the filming, but Bert Stern loved that hat. But the performance of Sweet Georgia Brown was one of the great performances of that number ever. I mean, and that's what happened with that.
No, but Bert Stern was a fashion photographer, and he, you know, that was his element. He really knew how to, you know, how to feature her. Although Bert Stern gets much of the credit for that film, which was, how many of you saw it? But the real brain behind that film was Aram Avakian. It was George Avakian's younger brother. And he knew how to make films, which Bert Stern did not. He was a still photographer. And Aram's never gotten enough credit for that.
Can I ask George a question? George, I asked you this before, but you know, the 1969 Newport Jazz Festival specifically, I know was so much different from all the rest of them, because you had Sly and the Family Stone, you had James Brown, you had 10 years after, I believe you had Led Zeppelin closing the night, but you also had Miles, Dave Brubeck. So what made you go the rock route that year?
Well, first of all, I kept hearing, reading in the underground press, how great these musicians were, that was a better flute player, that Ian Anderson was a better flute player than Roland Kirk, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And I kept reading about this drummer was better than Elvin Jones,
oh,
you know.
Ginger
and
Baby.
Yeah. And I had a friend, a kid that worked for me, his name was Joe Boyd, and he later became a big rock impresario. But I says, Joe, pick out the best of these groups that are musical. We had the Mothers of Invention 10 years after Jethro Tull. You know, I had a rock festival. And I never had so many people in my life. But I mixed it in with jazz, and you had Stefan Grappelli and the world's greatest jazz band on the stage in front of Led Zeppelin or something. Right. And that night, there was a tinderbox in Newport. I mean, it could have exploded because there were more people than we ever had. Sly had been on the stage, and he was going higher, 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 and the people were just, and I had lost control completely. And Led Zeppelin was closing the festival, and I wasn't going to put them on. I said, I can't. Well, they were going to say, we're going to set up in the street and play. I said, well, I'll let you go on if you do one thing. And I said, after your drum solo, and I learned this from Duke Ellington the night in 1956 when after Paul Gonzalez had excited that whole crowd. You learn from the masters. I said, you tell Jimmy Page to play a slow blues, and that will bring the crowd right down. And that's exactly what happened. They played their drum solo, and the crowd was going crazy. And the Led Zeppelin thought I was crazy. You know, they really did. They talked about it for years. I just found out it's not my lack of respect for that music. I do have respect for that music and the musicianship that goes involved in it. But it's different from jazz. I mean, I just didn't want to be involved with that world. It's not my world, and I don't want to be involved with it. I mean, there's some great musicians in that world, and I have tremendous respect for them. But it's a money business. Money is what rules that business. Jazz, unfortunately for a lot of musicians, is not ruled by money.
Money!
George, you tell the story in your book in, I think it's the same year, 1969, that Nina Simone had canceled. And I think it was Roberta Flack who would end up going on for her. Do you remember that story, what happened?
That was on the road from New York. I pass it every so often, New Brunswick. We did a festival in the school field, on the football field. And Nina didn't make it, but my friend Ogilvy, what was his first name? He was managing, found this woman in Washington. Says, you have to put her on, she's very good. So I said, well, all right, we had a lot of artists that night. I can't remember everybody. I said, do you have 15 minutes? It's Roberta Flack. And she sang, and we had to keep telling her, do another, do another, do another. She was on about 40 minutes. She was so great. And that was the first time any of us had ever heard her. And of course, she went on to this great career. She always used to dedicate a song to me. I guess it was the first time I ever saw your face. I always And she's still out there. She's still great, Roberta Flack.
Ultimately, Dan, what do you think is the value of the Newport Jazz Festival, looking at it from sort of the big macro picture?
Well, ultimately, it gave birth to the jazz festival genre, which has become a universal phenomenon. Aside from that, it brought so many performers to the attention of a much larger audience than if they had been confined to nightclubs and stuff. And it also served, there were wonderful things at Newport that brought new talent to the attention of the jazz world. Remember when Jimmy Smith was one of the greatest organ players ever, performed in the afternoon. He pulled up in a hearse. That's how he carried his organ, in a hearse. And that was just, he's outswung everybody. Cecil Taylor, first time that Cecil Taylor played for more than a handful of people in a club somewhere, with a wonderful group, a quartet with Steve Lacy, all these things. You know, over the years, and it's hard to believe that it's 60 years now, you could make an endless list of artists who were brought to wider attention by the festival. The things that have, it was significant in Miles Davis's career. He was sort of, quote unquote, rediscovered at Newport. It's, you know, the history of jazz really has to consider the Newport Jazz Festival as a major chapter.
Question here. Go ahead, sir.
I was wondering if any of you exchanged notes and have visited other jazz festivals, Montreal, Monterey, the ones in Europe, New Orleans, and what has been learned from, what did they learn from Newport and vice versa? And similarly, what, if any, connections has there been with the jazz festival and the Newport Folk Festival?
Well, all the festivals are cousins to a degree. There is an organization of international jazz festivals. Newport is a member of that, and Monterey is a member, and Montreal is a member of that. But each of them have their distinct personalities. The folk festival grew out of the fact of a love for music that I had. I had these musicians like Pete Seeger had played at my club in Boston. Odetta had played there. And we used to schedule afternoon programs at Newport. That's where we first had Mahalia Jackson in a gospel afternoon. We had a tap dance afternoon with all the great tap dancers, Bunny Briggs, and you know, and all of those great ones. And I said, why don't we do a folk afternoon? And I put Pete Seeger and the Weavers and Odetta and the Kingston Trio, and we had such a demand for it. I said, there's a festival here. And so we started the folk festival. And what happened with the folk festival was after the riot at Newport in 60, which was a riot, not at the festival, but in the towns, much more than the other time, by the way, an actual physical riot. And when I went back, I went up to see Pete Seeger, and my wife and I went up there to see Pete and Toshi at their, on their mountain up in Beacon. And Pete said, well, we should survive, keep it going, but I want all the musicians to work for $50 a night plus expenses to get there, no matter who they were. Only Pete Seeger could have done this. Only Pete Seeger, because the respect the world had for him. They came, everybody, Johnny Cash and the biggest name, Janis Joplin was the biggest, but they all came for $50 a night. And of course, there's a letter that the Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame just asked, they got it. It was from my wife to Bob Dylan. I was telling him he was going to get $50 for his of course, that was one of the, for about 7 years, from 1962, or 63, I guess it was, to 1970. Was one of the great musical experiences that anyone could have ever seen. And because it was all involved with civil rights, it was all involved with the growth of new music and new faces like James Taylor and Arlo Guthrie and Joni Mitchell. They were the new faces in the afternoon. And that festival, unfortunately, believe it or not, was destroyed by one of the people that made it so important. That was Bob Dylan the night he went away. That was the beginning of the end. It took a couple of years.
Telecast. And in order to do the Grammy telecast with Mr. Brubeck, I would have had to miss the first day of recording with Horace Silver. So Horace said, well, I'm sorry, you either got to make all 4 days or you can't make any of the recording. So I'm calling Mr. Brubeck. I'm telling him my conundrum. He's like, well, let me call Horace. Let me see if I can talk to him. See if we can work. see if we can work this out. I never wound up having an opportunity to get back from LA in time to do the recording session with Horace. But We did keep in touch, and anytime I was in Los Angeles, he always came out to hear the group, and but I never got a chance to play with him. But I still have all of the music that he sent me from the Hard Bop Grandpops. So I just listen to the record, and I look at the music, and I just go, well, it's all good, though.
Man, Horace Silver was funky. He played piano in a way that I love to think about him as a jazz musician, but you could also hear that he had the sensibility of a funk musician in the way that he would accompany everybody in the band and how he would write bass lines, like Christian was saying, melodies that you can remember and bass lines that throughout the whole song, they would stay the same and hold everything down, which is very simple. It's akin to the repetitive nature of funk music and groove music, but it still was jazz. And I think that, you know, that's something that I really learned from him. A couple things that, although I never got to hear him live, when I was younger, I was influenced by his music in a few different ways. The first time was in the ninth grade when I was in, it was the high school jazz band at Grace King High in Metairie, Louisiana. And I just started playing jazz and, you know, just figuring out the repertoire. And we played Song for My Father. I never will forget because that was the tune I got the solo on. So I figured out how to get all of my blues licks into it and get to a vibe where the audience always would clap, and I would get house on that one. So that's one good memory I had of Horace. And another one was with Ellis Marcellus. Around that same time, I started to study with as many people in New Orleans as I could to really get deeper into jazz and figure out who should I listen to, what should I do, how do I learn how to play this. So, you know, he would talk about different things like learning songs and learning lyrics, standards and everything like that. And also he would bring up musicians every now and again, and he would say, have you checked out Horace Silver? And I was like, not really. And then he looked at me and he was like, why? And I was like, I don't know. And he was like, check out Horace Silver. So I did. And ever since then, I've been listening to his recordings and enjoying them. And it's very sad to see that he passed, but it's a great legacy he left behind.
Horace was a perfectionist, and he represented an era of jazz, which in a sense has been lost. Because Horace had a sound, he had his music, and he wanted his group to play his music. And he kept his group together through all the problems of just doing that, holding a group together. But people like Art Blakey did that, and Dave Brubeck did that, and the Modern Jazz Quartet did that. That groups developed a sound. And the only way you could do that was with a strong leader that had a dedication to his music. And Horace personified that. And I'm very sad to hear he passed. He's been very sick, and he was a really important figure in jazz. And we've missed him for many years because he has been ill. But look, he was someone that once you knew him, he had a really beautiful personality and was a wonderful human being.
He was one of the hardest swingers. Boy, could he, and he would work up a sweat. I don't know how many of you remember seeing Horace, but he would come off a set and he would be soaking wet.
Our final question tonight, because we're almost out of time, we'll go to you, George. How much of your personal legacy do you think is the legacy of Newport? How closely connected are they?
I don't know. One never knows what their legacy is. I know I went back to Newport. I sold my company about 5 years ago. But I was still working with them, and the people that bought it didn't understand what was happening, and they ran their own business into the ground. And I said, I can't let Newport die. And I just can't do that. because it is my life. It is what I am today is because I had the opportunity to go to Newport. And the important thing that it has done is to create so many jazz festivals throughout the world. There might be about 1,000 jazz festivals in the world. Now, I'm not underestimating that number. And that means a sense of employment. It means a sense of public relations for jazz. Because every time a festival comes to town, the newspapers write about it, the radio talks about it, when they don't mention it the rest of the year. But when a festival comes to town, there is promotion for this great music. And so if that is my legacy, okay. But whatever it is, I'm glad I'm a living legend. Because living is the important
thing. Morgenstern and Christy McBride and John Batiste. Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you. Fantastic. Real pleasure, sir. Thank you.